Everybody, today we are going to have some discussion, you know, about the integrated water resource management, and of course, another topic will be about the participatory process, or on irrigation, we will call it PIM or participatory irrigation management. Okay, and by the end of this discussion, we will have some of the evaluation. Okay, and you have it on the on your system. Okay, first, let's have a look, you know, on the what are we going to discuss today. Okay, it's about this. Okay, why integrated water resource management is so important, you know. Okay. But before we go there, I'm going to have some guidelines for our today discussion. First, we have a look why water management is important and why do we need better water management. And of course, the new development in the last 20 years or more, you know, about the water resource management, integrated water resource management that is accepted worldwide, that is the good approach, you know, that more integrate the other issue into water resource rather than itself alone, you know. And one of the key component or the success of the IWRM is the participatory irrigation management, you know. And finally, today we are going to have a look at the experience of Thailand in using PIM as a tool for water management and irrigate water management, and how did we do that, and the result, you know, of that, of some achievement that I can share with you. Okay, first, let's have a look at this picture from IMI, you know, is a world water situation, you know, concerning water scarcity, you know. You can see that the world can be separated into many groups. The red one, that means the water is very scarce, you know. The orange one is less. The yellow is about medium, and the blue, the fifth group, that is the water is not so much scarce, you know. So Thailand is among the country that we have quite abundant of water. It doesn't mean that we have more water than the other country in the region, but we have quite abundant of water because we have developed, you know, a lot of reservoir, a lot of irrigation project, let's say in the last 60 years, that's why we are now, okay? And I think that the development of new reservoirs in Thailand will be not so much, be quite minimal, you know, except some, you know, important area as the economic area, you know. Like may you have heard about Thailand now have initiate the Eastern Economic Corridor, that is the one of the area that we have a new development project. Apart from that, will be not so much development. Okay, and is it just give you the detail of the how the water scarcity was analyzed? They use the first criteria is the percentage of the increase in water withdrawal, and the second one they use the annual water resources at the percentage of total water. And you can see that, you know, Thailand is quite in a good shape, yet we maybe need not so much new development in water supply, okay? And some, okay, but when we have a look in the next few years, or let's say in the future, you know, many countries in the world we have also, we call it a physical water scarcity or economic water scarcity, you know. In case of Thailand, we will have kind of economic water scarcity. It doesn't mean that we have water shortage, but we have kind of competition, you know, between sectors. Because in the past, most of the water in Thailand have been used for agriculture, you know, through irrigation project, you know. And up to now, we still use more than 70% of water for agriculture. But the water for domestic water supply and the water for industry and even the water for, let's say, environmental concern, it's getting more, you know. That's why we have kind of sharing some water from agriculture to the other sectors, okay? Then it's just the figures to show us how is the food price, because food price is also related to agriculture and also related to water somehow, you know. And you can see that, you know, the food price, let's say from 2003 up to last year, had increased, you know, steadily. Actually, you know, from 2003 to last year, it increased by double, you know. That's why we have some crisis of food price now today. And even in 2022, this crisis will be even more, you know, because we have a kind of crisis in energy. We have high price of fuel. That's why it even have a food price crisis even worse, you know. So that is why water resource is quite important, and irrigation, you know, for the agricultural food production and for food production. Okay. Let's have a look at the, you know, the use of water worldwide. You know, in this figure, you can see that on the left side, that is talking about water for agriculture or non-agriculture, you know. And on the top, you know, we have a look at the regions of the world that are coming together to be this figure, you know. You know, for also on the top is about the region, you know, it's a Asian and non-Asian. And on the right, it separate about the agriculture and non-agriculture. So if we have a look at the water use, for Asia, it's about 60% of the world, because we have a lot of monsoon, you know. And also non-Asia is only 40%. And if we have a look at the agriculture and non-agriculture, you know, overall is about 70% for agriculture. For in Thailand, it's about the same, you know. We in Thailand, for the water for agriculture, it's about maybe 75%. And the other is about 25, but in this figure, overall it's 70% for agriculture and 30% for the other. Okay, so agriculture, you know, in Asia, you know, it's quite important and use a lot of water here. From this figure, you see that, okay, the total amount of water in the world that used for agriculture in Asia is about 49%, you know, on the block right here in this figure, you can see that. That's why Asia is quite important for agricultural production, okay? And a lot of use for that, okay? Next, have a look at some of the work of the FAO that, you know, summarize the water and agriculture in Asia, you know. Because of we have developed many irrigation projects in the past, and this study show that the failure you know, on the operation and maintenance, you know, of previously developed irrigation project, it become a issue. Okay, and in order to elevate, you know, the level of the management, the irrigation management transfer, you know, have been introduced, and also the development of the water use association also have been promoted, you know, and the discussion today, we will have a look on the, you know, the participation, you know, maybe going through the participant through the public project or the participation through the irrigation that have been already transferred to the water user project, you know. And this have something to do with the Water Youth Association. And actually, tomorrow, you know, we are going to have a look at the case study of the water use water user group that in one of the basin in Thailand that we have so much successful in, you know, water use water user group, you know, that have been participate in water management. We have two example of. One is the large irrigation project, you know, and the other one is just small irrigation project operated by the farmers, you know. But unfortunately, your guy cannot be here, so we will have some video to share with you, you know, the, and on some of the okay slideshow to show you about how they achieve, you know, the participatory process and water user group activity. Okay. And this is just to summarize, you know, the issue about water fee, you know, that water fee is quite important, you know, but water fee is should be collect to at least cover the cost of the operation and maintenance. But actually in Thailand, you know, we haven't collect the water fee for agriculture. Mostly we collect the water fee only for, you know, some project that we need have like pumping, and the farmer have to pay for electricity fee, you know, but apart from that, the water fee is not really correct from the farmer in Thailand, but they will participate in some other form in kind, like maintenance, labor, those kind of thing, you know. And in this, you know, the study have concluded the strengthening of the water user group or water user association is quite important, you know. And the other thing is, you know, the crop intensification and the performance of project is also the kind of highlight for the Asian, you know. And the other thing is about the crop diversification, you know, because of, for example, Thailand, you know, we are the big producer of rice. But, you know, probably in the near future, we will diversify our crop from rice to some other crop that is like probably fruit, you know, that it make much more profit, you know, and some of the few crops, you know, and some of the cash crop, you know, okay. And the other issue is about the rehabilitation. You know, that when the project have been used for a long, long time, you know, and somehow we need to, let's say, modernize, or we need, you know, kind of make it get back to the shape, you know, because of probably many irrigation projects, including in Thailand, is the maintenance is probably is insufficient, you know, that's why we have some deterioration. If the deterioration is big, the rehabilitation process has to be implemented. And at the same time, when we implement the rehabilitation, the modernization is added in. Like in Thailand, we have put many, let's say, monitoring system, automatic one, you know, like we call it SCADA system, you know, in the most of the major control structure in the irrigation project in Thailand, you know. Okay, the next one, the research talk about the competition between sector. Like I discussed earlier, you know, we have a rapid growth for the water in the other sector, like domestic and industrial, you know, especially in Thailand, the industrial have been developed a lot, you know, and more water have been to be share or transfer from agriculture sector to some domestic and industrial, you know. And that's why the integrated water resource management is important, you know, in order to have the forum to discuss about overall water land issues, some other related, you know, together to come out with the, let's say, best solution, you know, for water management. And lastly here, you know, they talk about, you know, the self-sufficient for crop production. You know, that will be some issue for some country. Like now, we have a kind of supply chain crisis and energy crisis in the world. So the self-sufficient for the food or crop production is quite important for many countries. You know, and even in the future, many countries will try to have their own sufficient in terms of crop and food. This just show you how, you know, about the renewable water resource in the country around the world, you know, and if you have a look at the Southeast Asian, you can see that, you know, Indonesian have much more water than the other, and then Malaysia, Philippines, Vietnam, and then Thailand. Actually, Thailand haven't got that much water, you know, but we have developed so many water resource projects and reservoirs in most of the important river basin. That's why we have a good condition or good water safety. You know, let's say that we have not so much water scarcity in the country. Okay, from this article, we will show you that. Okay, this is just kind of irrigation area in the country around the world. You can see that Thailand is on the mid here. You know, Thailand is here. You can see the red is on the place where I am now, in the central plain. So in the central plain, we have huge irrigation area. Actually, the majority of the irrigation area in Thailand is on the central plain. See, it is a flat area. So more than half of the area is the irrigation area, you know. And the other part of the country is less, you know. And some other countries have a huge irrigation area, like in China, you know, in Japan, in Korea, you know, of course, many areas in Europe, you know, too. So next, let's have a look at the overall problems in water resources, you know. First one is about the population under threat. You know, you can see that so many countries or many regions, we have water shortage or water stress, you know. And the other thing is about the water pollution. You know, water pollution has become a big problem in many countries. And in Thailand, even though we don't have much problem of water stress, but we have problem of water pollution, you know, this because of we are lack of the, you know, the treatment system for the wastewater. We have some, but it's still, insufficient, compared to the number of wastewater that have been produced. So that's why we have the water pollution, especially, in the central plain, that is next to the Gulf of Thailand. The last picture you see is the Gulf of Thailand on the south of central plain. And the major river is just flow into the Gulf of Thailand. That's why we have some problem about water pollution and water quality, in many river, in the central plain. Okay. And here we also recognize about the water governance crisis, that is related to poor water management, Why? Because of the water management in many countries have kind of a sectoral approach, like in Thailand, we also have that, we have so many departments, working on water resources. Actually, we have maybe around five major departments work on water resource. And overall, we have more than 20, department that is working on water resource. That is why it's quite not easy, for good management, because we have so many agencies looking for different issue, like water for agriculture, and then water resource conservation, and water for fishery, water and use of the waterway for transportation, and many other, and all is allocated to different department, And so the next one is on the top down institution, We still have a lot of centralized governance, So it means that we have a big central government, and we have regional office, and then we have a local office. Okay, so this kind of thing. So, and of course, the inefficient governance or the inefficiency of the organization working together, have raised the problem of the competition of the water use. And that's why the integrated water resource management is become more and more important to have the forum, or to have the framework for the all organization and all parties, to work together, under the same framework. Okay. And this is just the quite common water resource project in Thailand. My first picture is about the one of the oldest system that we have used. It's called the weir or kind of regulator in the stream or in the river. On the this is one on the left, that is a Mayom on the north of Thailand, and on the right is the Metang. We are it's also on the north of Thailand too, that is quite common for the northern part of the country, which have a mountainous area, to have the weir, in the main river or stream as a head structure for the project. And then we have irrigation canal from the left picture. You can see that we have the irrigation canal there, on the upstream of the weir. Okay. And secondly, is the most popular, approach for Thailand now today. The first one that is about the northern part, but the other part of the country, mostly we use dams and reservoir here, and the top left, that is Kasir Dam in the central plain, as a central part of the country. And the right hand, that is another dam in the northeastern called Lampau. Okay, that is quite important for Thailand, the last reservoir. You know, actually, the majority of water in Thailand now is have been stored by the big reservoir, you know, and have been distributed downstream or through the canal. Okay. And the other system that we have here is the combination, you know, of the storage dam and diversion dam. You know, this means that the diversion dam is far away upstream. So we need to have another diversion dam. The storage dam is very much upstream. So we have a diversion dam at the downstream. Let's say on the top, you know, the left hand is a Kangkachan, that is storage dam. And the right is a pit dam, that is a kind of diversion dam, you know, and you can see, that the picture, we cannot see the canal, but the canal actually is upstream on the left hand and on the right hand side. You know, the other one that have been used for Thailand now today is a pumping station. You know, here is one of the pumping station on the northern part of Thailand, you know, as and actually most of the pumping station will be situated on the river that upstream probably we have some kind of facility, you know, to store the water, and downstream far away, probably sometime we have a pumping station here, okay? And the last type of development for big irrigation project or big water resource project in Thailand is about groundwater. And this picture, we show the only large-scale groundwater development in Thailand is called Sukhothai Groundwater Project. You know, it's in very much north of Thailand. You know, we have a good aquifer, you know, good water resort in underground, you know. That's why we developed this. We use kind of 200 pumps, you know, each pump about 200 cubic meter per ounce, you know. That's quite a lot of water, you know. And I think what I remember is this project used about 40 million cubic meter of water per year, you know, for the area around let's say how many hectare? 10,000 hectare, you know, a little bit more than 10,000 hectare. You know, that's quite a lot of irrigation area, and mostly they go rice and the green on the right hand mostly go rice, and the orange on the left, that mostly they go field crops. You know, okay. Let's have a look at the small scale, you know, water resource project, you know. Apart from the, you know, big or large scale, we also have a lot of small scale, you know, and on the top we have the natural stream, you know, that we only have the irrigation kind of directly connect, you know, to the stream, which means that this stream have good, you know, water flow throughout the year. And the second one is the pond in the natural stream. What that is mean? It means that if we have a lot of public land nearby the stream, we will kind of enlarge, you know, the stream into a pond nearby, you know, and we store the water in that, and we use that as the water storage, and we be, you know, diverse this water for use or some other mean for use later, okay. And the other small scale in Thailand is the weir, river weir, you know. So it's much smaller than the last project or the stream that we mentioned earlier, you know. So the weir can store probably not so much water. That this means that the upstream need to have a kind of flow at least some certain time of the year. And we also have the small reservoir, you know, that is actually not operated by the agency. The reservoir mostly after completion, you know, it will be transferred to local administration or the water user group. You know, what is classified between small reservoir and the other side is capacity. You know, so the reservoir capacity less than 1 million cubic meter is considered to be small reservoir in Thailand. You know, if it's more than that, more than let's say 1 million up to 100 million, we call it medium scale storage or reservoir. But if any reservoir have the storage more than 100 million, we will call that you know, the large scale. Okay. Oh, maybe people discuss about the borehole in Thailand that, you know, have a 200 cubic meter per hour, you know, in the north of Thailand. That is not quite common, you know. It's just for some particular area that have very good aquifer, you know, that whereby we develop a very large scale, you know, groundwater there. And actually, maybe it's the best aquifer in the north of the country. Okay. Actually, in the central, we have quite a good aquifer, but since we have a lot of irrigation project that divert the water from the big reservoir from the north and from the other part to the central plain, that's why we don't have much use of the large scale groundwater in the central plain, but we use of the surface instead. But many farmers also have used some kind of shallow well to be supplementary, you know, for the irrigation for the central plain. Okay. Okay, is it just a farm pond? That's quite common for the farm in Thailand now. You know, we have a farm pond, probably the size is kind of, let's say, 2,000 square meter, something around there, you know, and the depth about 3 to 5 meters. You know, that is quite maybe sufficient for agriculture and maybe sufficient for household, some other activity. That's quite common in Thailand, you know, to have a farm pond, you know, and it's, let's say that for farm pond in Thailand, we have at least 200,000 of them, you know, around, okay. And is it just another pumping station for some smaller scale, you know, from the river, probably is a smaller river or the irrigation or the catchment area is smaller. Let's say kind of maybe 50 hectare, something like that, you know, or maybe less, you know, let's say mostly about 50 hectare, you know, become a small pumping station, you know. And of course, we have some small groundwater for some other area, not as big as I showed earlier in the north, okay? So next topic, we're going to have a look at the integrated water resource management. You know, why integrated water resource management is important? Because it is a better management process. You know, they have been proved and accept worldwide. You know, it promotes the governance, it increase the stakeholder participation, you know, and it certainly will promote the sustainability, you know, so it's balanced between the development and the conservation, okay? This is just the, have a look at the water use, you know, that we have a water use for people, you know, that means the water supply. We have water use for food, mostly for agriculture, for fishery, you know, for animals. And we have water for nature, that is for ecology, you know. And of course, in many parts of the world, including Thailand, now we have water for industry and other use. Actually, in Thailand, you know, water is also important for, let's say, custom or festival, or let's say that, you know, it's a cultural thing, you know, like we have, maybe you have heard about Songkran festival in Thailand, that is called, we can call it water festival, you know, that is the mid of the summer, you know, we have that, you know, actually it's a former Thai New Year day, you know, now today we have changed to the international calendar, but in the past our New Year is in April, you know, and also we have kind of Loy Kathom, you know, that is also in let's say November, when the water level in the river is high, we have kind of floating of the, you know, kind of let's say material, you know, that it made for floating in the river to celebrate, you know, the after the harvesting season, you know. And we also have a boat racing, you know, by, you know, by rowing the boat, you know, and it's all become a still popular activity for, you know, kind of ceremony in Thailand. Okay. And on the left, you know, we have the three issue, the all three framework to support the water use, that is the environment, in the institution, and the instrument, you know, that is to support, you know, the indicate water resource management, you know. And actually, you know, the principle of the integrated water resource management have been initiated by four main principles. You know, first of all, we have to recognize that water is a finite and vulnerable resource. So it means that maybe it can renew, but if the quality or the water source is damaged, you know, it may take time or maybe difficult to recover. And of course, it can be renewed, but somehow it limits for each year. And the fluctuation in terms of amount of water annually is quite high. And actually, let's say for the example of Thailand, nowadays, you know, the kind of the fluctuation in terms of annual rainfall and annual flow, it becomes much more and more critical. You know, we have more of frequent droughts, frequent flood, you know, compared to the past. You know, that's why it's quite important on the issue. Secondly, it's on the participatory approach that is quite important, you know, because it if the we include the people into the management scheme, you know, or management program, it will be much more effective, you know, and it will fit with the water need, with the need of the people, you know. And the third issue here, they are talking about the role of women, you know, maybe it's a problem in some country, you know, but for Thailand, we don't have the problem of this, you know. And lastly is, you know, we need to have a look at water as economic goods. So maybe water is free in the past. People don't think it's really valuable, you know, but in Thailand right now, you know, it's just become more and more important for people to have a look at the value of water. Actually, in the past, when we have a look at irrigation project, mostly we have a look only at the irrigation efficiency, you know, how much water we save, how much water we lost. But now today, we have a look more on the what called the water productivity. What does this mean? Water productivity means it with 1 cubic meter of water, how much income the farmer receive. You know, if they grow rice, how many baht per cubic meter from rice, how many baht per cubic meter from fruit, you know. Actually, sorry, I haven't shown the figure for you here. The water productivity in Thailand, rice is among the lowest one, you know, per cubic meter. And the highest one probably is the fruit, you know, but actually right now, you know, for export in Thailand in terms of agriculture product, you know, fruit help make more money than any other. You know, fruit become more and more important because it's quite expensive, you know, and popular in many country for Thai fruit, you know. So from the figure last year, fruit production for export make the most of the money in terms of export. And rice now is only number 4 in Thailand. You know, I think the second one is kind of sugarcane and its product, you know, and third one is kind of maybe cassava or rubber. I cannot remember. Okay. Okay, this is the importance of the integrated water resource management. You know what, why we have a challenge to balance. On the left, you know, is the nature or likelihood. You know, we need a good nature. You know, we could get a good ecosystem. But on the same time, we need to develop for the good of humankind. You know, so it means the resource. You know, the development. So it, you have to balance between conservation and development. You know, that why IWRM have played a role in here. You know, try to balance it. And is it just I mentioned earlier that the environment, you know, that you have to be into support the IWRM is the first is the animal environment. You know, that is mean do we have the policy? We have registration, we have the cooperation, we have the mechanism for participation. You know, secondly, do we have institutional role? You know, like we have the management, we have the capacity building, we have the action have been implemented. And the other one is the management instrument. Do we have regulation? We have economic tool, we have an allocation system, those kind of thing, you know. So how do we measure it? We measure by three constraints. The first constraint is the economic, of course, economic efficiency, you know, because of the IBRM, after all, we also need to have a look at economics, you know. And the other one, it also important, is social equity, you know. What does this mean? It means that the people who are unfortunate, how much water do they receive compared to the maybe people who have more opportunities, you know, to access the water, or compared between water for at the upstream and downstream, do they have so much different? You know, of course there may be some different, but how much is that acceptable? Okay, if people upstream receive maybe 30% more than people at the downstream, it'd be okay. But if the people at the upstream receive double of people at the downstream, is it acceptable? Probably for the social equity, it's not, you know. And lastly, here is it talk about ecological sustainability. Okay, it has to be sure that development still keep the ecology or the environmental issue on the good shape. Okay. So in case of Thailand, you know, we have shared with you some story regarding the IWRM in Thailand, you know. And actually I have been involved in this process quite a lot from the last maybe more than 20 years up to now, you know. Because right now I'm luckily to be elected as a member of National Water Committee, you know. First of all, there are no general blueprint for each country. It's, what does it mean? It means that every country have to find your own or our own roadmap. What is a good system? What is a suitable system for us? And the other thing is the IBOM has to be adjusted according to social economics, to the political, to the cultural, you know, conditions of each country. For example, in Thailand, cultural thing is quite important. You know, like I talked earlier, you know, we have so many celebrations related to water, you know. And of course, socioeconomic, you know, is also important and political apart from the economics, okay? And lastly, you know, we need to have a roadmap, you know, or action, you know, okay, where do we start? And what is the next step? What is the next step? You know, and, you know, finally, what is our target of achievement you know, otherwise, if you we don't have the roadmap, it kind of you know, no direction, it's difficult, you know, to have a success, you know, in terms of implementing the IWIM. So in Thailand, you know, we recognize the three components of the IWIM, you know, like environment, institute, management tool, you know. First, you know, we start by building the consensus among various stakeholders. So we have a lot of meeting, we have a lot of discussion. First, government official have to agree, and we also exchange with academics, you know. We also talk with the private sector, farmer user group, some other groups, and also NGO to agree, okay, this is a good approach for Thailand to go forward. And we have the first dialogue and seminar extensively in 1999, you know, that is about how much, 23 years, you know. Years ago, okay, and we have put the three basic components into the national water resource management system. You know, so what does it mean? It means we internationalize the IWIM into the government machinery, you know, to move this process forward. Okay, so we have the three components in place. You know, after everybody agree that it's important, okay, and it will be the direction we are going to go. So we have, let's say, national water vision, you know, so we start to have, okay, vision for the country that, okay, what is people's view of the future, you know, by the multi-stakeholder, you know. And after that, this vision have been endorsed by the government, you know, in 2000, you know, and this vision have been translated into the, let's say, 9 policy. Actually, it's the first 9 policy talking about water, you know, like, okay, water have to be available for household use. I think one of that say that, okay, well, for household water have to be available for all household in Thailand, in the country, and many other, you know. I think, and the last of 9 say that we need to have some kind of water law, you know, okay, in order to manage or regulate water in the country, you know. Okay, sorry that I didn't show you all of them here, but that kind of the first roadmap that, okay, we need to have to be sure that water will be available for household and some other issue, you know. And lastly, we are looking for water laws, you know. So we have the first national policy in 2000, you know, that is quite not so long, you know, it's about only 22 years, you know, compared to the history of water use or water management in Thailand, that it go on for many hundred years. But the first national policy just start about 2000. So we also start to have the first called River Basin Committee. So we have divided the country into 25 basins. That's quite some time ago. The 25 basin probably start about 30 years ago. You know, 30 years ago. That is about 1990, I would say that. Or actually, around 1990, we have 90 or 92, we have the separate, define the country into 25 major river basin, you know. And from this agreement in 1999, we have initiated the River Basin Committee for the first time. You know, and of course, capacity building is quite important because it's new, you know, people mostly work independently. And now we work as the basin, you know, under the IWIM framework, you know. Of course, inside the River Basin Committee, we have kind of working group, subcommittee, like we have subcommittee for academics. We have a subcommittee for planning, those kind of things. Because I was involved in this process since the start, you know, and also, of course, when we have some issue inside the basin, we can initiate some kind of working groups, you know, to solve that problem, you know, and this kind of subcommittee and working group have to be integrated into the system. We also have, you know, kind of comprehensive and integrated water sector, you know, budgetary procedure. So now the budget of water resource in the past, before we introduced the IBOM, it just by each agency and it no direction. But when we have this IBOM framework, the direction for budgeting, it have been fit into the river basin law, you know. For approval, at least have a look at the budget. Is it fit with the direction of the development of the basin, you know, or of the national policy, you know? Okay, so this is quite good that in 2002, the budgetary procedure have to be also endorsed by the River Basin Committee. Yeah. And of course, we have preparation of river basin plan. You know, this is the first plan in 2001. So East Basin now have the river basin plan. Before that, it's unclear, you know, how East Basin will go along, you know. So in order to do this, we have to work together with various stakeholders in order to identify the problems, need, the formulation and the plan, you know, and the potential of the water resources, you know, that's the kind of thing. You know, it's kind of, you know, we start to have work together as a people who are involved in water resources or in river basin. And of course, you know, the IWM have become the, you know, let's say the practice in the river, in the river basin. Okay. Of course, we have institutional reform. You know, after that, we initiate the Department of Water Resources in 2002 to be responsible to be the secretary of River Basin Committee. You know, and it under the new Ministry of Natural Resource and Environment. You know, initially we try to sweep the Department of Royal Irrigation Department into this ministry. You know, but unfortunately we cannot do that. So for Thailand now, the Royal Irrigation Department is still under the Ministry of Agriculture. You know, it also the agency that have been involved in water management, it may be it's not here. So we still not so much kind of unity yet, you know, in terms of water is still in many ministry, not in one ministry or in the same area or same framework, okay? So the ministry, you know, have mostly the function of regulation of national water resource management, you know. But let's say the ID is still not here yet, okay, even now today. And we have draft the national water laws. Actually, we have so many drafts, you know, in the last 20 or 30 years, you know. You know, this one is talking about the draft in 1998, you know. Okay, but at that time, it's not so successful. It has been passed to be the law, you know. But have good news to tell you that now today we have water laws. But it's just about, let's say, 4 years ago, you know, that we have the first water laws, okay. And we have initiated the 25 River Basin Committee. At first, we call it River Basin Subcommittee, you know. And in 2008, you know, this subcommittee have been upgraded to River Basin Committee, you know, by the regulation, you know. And this is just recently, you know, what have been done in Thailand, you know. First of all, we have national water strategy for the first time in 2015. This is for 20 years plan, national water strategy. You see, in the past, we have kind of a national water vision, but that vision is not compulsory. People can have it's kind of guideline, but nowadays it's a strategy. It means that every department related to water have to follow this national water strategy. And we have 20 year plan from 2015 to 2035, okay? Of course, and we have the first office to replace the Department of Water Resource. You know, we call it Office of National Water Resource to be the center, you know, or the regulator of water resource in Thailand, you know, in 2017. And 1 year later, we have new water laws in 2018, you know. And among the first work that have been done, we have improved the river basin from 25 to 22, you know, because that 25 basin is the start about, let's say, 30 years ago on the basic that, okay, we try to have a river basin rather than work at the overall pictures. But some basin at that time is quite, you know, ineffective, you know, for operation, you know, because it has been very, very quick initiated by some small group of people, you know. But in 2021, we have looked overall and grouping them again to be a more effective, you know. And last year, it has been announced, and including the map and the sub-basin and those kind of things all together. So in summary, regarding water resource, you know, we need to have a roadmap, you know, and it takes time, of course. You can see the experience of Thailand take 10, 20 years, you know, but maybe some other country doesn't take much, as much time as Thailand, you know. And we need to have a group of key players, you know, so it can be academics, it can be a policy maker, it can be something, you know, to push the government to endorse, you know, the roadmap and the action plan and for the program, you know. And one of the critical factor is, you know, to have the objective of the IWIM, you know, and we have to be also patient, you know, for them to work for us. Okay. So you have to be step-by-step process, you know. And we have to go and working through the river basin plan, you know, for the IWIM process, you know. So is what did I say here is the application is more important than the plan, you know. So everybody can have so many plans, but actually that is have been implement, because so important is the plan have to be implement, not just there and nobody have a look at it and follow the plan. Okay. And lastly, here we talk about public awareness of the multi-stakeholder, you know. So we have stakeholder of the water user, you know, for agriculture, for domestic, you know, for industry, and probably we have to need somebody to have a look at ecology, somebody to have a look at the water use for energy, you know, water use for, let's say, cultural thing, you know, and some other thing, you know. And of course, they have so many other interest group of people, okay? So next, you know, we have a look at the PIM or participatory irrigation management. You know, it's quite an important process in water management. Actually, this picture show us the Larry is called Give Earth a Chance. It's kind of World Environmental Days. Then it's this one is from the 5th of June, 20 years ago. You know, they have a rally about, this is the north of Thailand, I think it's Chiang Mai, you know, in Ping River. You know, Ping River, where is Ping River? Let's go back to show you where is the Ping River. Here, Ping River is river basin number 6 here, you know, in the north of Thailand, in Chiang Mai. Maybe somebody you know about Chiang Mai in Thailand, you know, that is there. This Lali is in Chiang Mai, you know. Okay, this one. So the traditional PIM, you know, in Asia, you know, it's a kind of paddy irrigation system, you know. And it's based on the traditional, you know, rice growing cultural, you know, and it's still working. You know, and still functioning. So what is the important characteristic of the PIM? It has to be the sense of ownership. What does it mean? It means that people have to feel that they are the part or they are the owner of the system. Now, obligation, the system doesn't belong to the government. It have been not it have been belong to the people. So if the farmer own the system, you know, and they feel they have the feeling of their own ownership, they be kind of taking care of it and look after it and participate and maintain it, you know. And the farmer need to have the initiative, you know, in terms of protect and preserve this facility. So it connect to the first point. That if the ownership is there, you know, the activity in terms of protection, preserve, will be there. And the awareness of their rights, it means that it have their right to have a use of water, if their right to have clean water, if their right to protect the water for the next generation, those type of thing, you know. And we need, and we have a regulation of the water allocation and maintenance. And repair facility. Yeah. So then it means that in Thailand, the RID, you know, is the main organization that have a regulation on water allocation and have been have a job to do the maintenance and repair of the facility. But of course, people can have some kind of participation on this, but it's on the, let's say if we have the main system, we have the secondary system, and we then have the field ditch at the end, the farmer will probably have to participate at least on the field ditch in terms of maintenance, in terms of repair, and maybe farmer can participate in allocation on the secondary or on the field level, you know, that type of thing. So the in Asia, you know, water, you know, is mostly like I discussed earlier, is connected to the traditional, to the ceremony, to the religious rituals, and you know, through water for an agriculture. Okay. What's important? Why the harmony between water and traditional PIM? Because we have quite abundant of water, you know. Mm-hmm. But of course, it's quite important in the area where we have water shortage too, you know, like in the arid or sub-arid region, you know. So LBM is important for the area with abundant water, and also it can be implemented in the area of water shortage. Okay. But for the monsoon area, maybe we have water quite abundant. Yeah. So we still protect that, look at it at the environmental asset, you know, and of course we have a look at the economic issue too, but environmental issue had to be there, you know. So why participatory irrigation, why participatory is quite important. This come from the, you know, the Chinese Confucius, you know, that why participatory is important, you know. First of all, tell me, I forget. So it means that from the learning process, you know, if somebody tell you something, you know, you will remember and you follow and you practice, probably it may be less than or 10%, you know, we learn from that, okay? And then show me, I might remember that this maybe if you have a demonstration for people have look, maybe you gain maybe 30% more, you know, okay, learning of doing thing, you know, but most importantly, involve me, I will learn. This is kind of participatory that it has been emphasized, have been emphasized more than many thousand years ago, that participatory is important and is the key for success. Okay. So what is the issue of participation? You know, is a first of all, is a co-participation that we consider, you know, and secondly, the participate process. And next one is the how is it occur? Okay. So when we try to put into place, you know, we need to have a look at the, okay, what is the problem? And then we come out with the technique, structure or program. Okay, this is maybe we go very quick on this, the kind of techniques rather than practical. Okay, this is the participation thinking process. You know, we come to say, okay, why we do this? Who we do this? What are we to do? From where to where and how, you know? So the key decision that we have to make on the participatory, okay, problem or issue that need to participate. And second one is a alternative. Next one is the assessment. Last one is evaluate or choose what are we to do, you know, regarding this process, okay? This is just kind of precondition for participatory approach. You know, we need to have political commitment, you know, and mutual trust between government, officer, and people. Otherwise, it's hard to start, or it's hard to come out with the successful. Yeah. The other one is about the awareness about the economics, environmental and social that involve in the participatory, you know. Next one, we talk about equitable representation. You know, it means that maybe people who have influence a lot in the area participate more, and people who have place when do not participate at all. So how can we balance, you know, for the equitable of the presentation of the representation? Of course, the participatory need a type of governance, good governance, you know. And of course, lastly here it talk about access to reliable information. You know, if you have less opportunity, how can you have the access to the information? You know, so your background is the same as the other. you know. Okay, this is just a project that I used to work in the central west of Thailand, in the western region of Thailand. You know, it's a kind of meeting with water user group. Here it's called people are the heart of the development, you know, and it had to be the ultimate definition for this process. So the participation means that the stakeholder can share the control, can have influence, you know, on the development or on the decision of the resources, you know, that maybe have an effect on themselves. Sorry. So it have four main phases here. First, we talk about initiating. We talk about, okay, put the idea in place, and we have preparation, okay, and we have implementation. But most importantly, we need to have a sustaining. So it means that it have continuous process. It have been transferred to the people or to the farmer or to the group, and they have been accepted and they have been practiced continuously, you know. And we have discussed earlier that it had no single answer or single blueprints, because it depends on the social constraint, political constraint, you know, cultural constraint, those types of things. So it depends on various issues, that even economics here, okay? So the need for participation, you know, why do we need participation? Okay, it improves performance and sustainability of policy, program, and projects, okay? It has been improved worldwide, including Thailand. It's enhanced stakeholder capability and skills, you know, like the project that I will take you to have a look, you know, tomorrow, you know, is one of the project that, okay, we start, I cannot remember long when, more than 10 years ago, maybe 15 years, I can't remember now. Okay, we start with the meeting, we start with a discussion, and right now, you know, people have skill, you know, to transfer their participatory to the third generation already now. You know, we have a first generation to start the PIM in the project, and we have second generation, and now we have new, the third one who succeed, you know, do the program. And we have to empower the stakeholder, you know, here. So how come the stakeholder can be trained or have a capacity building, those types of things? And of course, ownership, as I said earlier, is important. You know, and we need to have the monitoring of the activity. Yeah. We have to have the motivate sustainable commitment. Actually, the picture here shows farmer participation in the maintenance of the irrigation. I think this is irrigation canal. You know, we have removed the weeds. You know, they have to remove the seal out of, you know, actually by our agreement between farmers, they have to do that every season before the irrigation season. Farmers have to participate in that, you know. They have to do that on the field dish, they have to do that on the, let's say, tertiary or let's say tertiary unit or secondary unit, whatever, you know, but the main channel mostly it leave responsible of the agency, not the farmer. Okay, and they, of course they have to participate in kind of operation, kind of monitoring, you know, because in Thailand in the past we used to have big number of officers in irrigation project, but now over the days that number have been decreased by more than half. So now today most of irrigation project on the lower level of the system, you know, let's say the main canal probably controlled by the government, probably some part of the secondary, but the tertiary and the field ditch have to be involved in control, monitoring, and maintenance also by the farmer. Mm-hmm. And here talk about the smoothing transition, you know, of the conceptual to the assessment, to design, to capacity building, implement, and then monitoring and evaluation of the process, okay? And we have to enhance the social capital and promote sound government, okay? And we have to avoid the external criticism about, you know, the process we're going on, okay? So how can we do that? We have to build consensus among people. Mm-hmm. And we have to avoid the or improve the conflict management. Actually, you know, many irrigation projects in Thailand are now, the conflict is have been resolved by the farmer themselves, not by the officer. You know, we have the farmer user group as a basic, and we have the kind of what we call integrated water user group, that is many water users combined together, you know, that we will discuss in detail tomorrow, you know. So the conflict amongst them, they will have their own regulation to solve or to resolve. And of course, somehow maybe they have some penalty themselves. Are they going to charge people by some money, or are they going to have penalty like, okay, you will not get the water in the next rotation or some other thing, you know, that have been practiced by water user group. Okay, and the picture here show the same project, patchwork operation and maintenance, that I will discuss with you more detail tomorrow about this project, this water user group, and some other project in this river basin. Within this river basin, I have been involved a lot in the last more than 10 years, you know. So we have something to share with you. And also I'm the one of the experts who are helping them on the participatory process there, and on also some of the other issue. Okay. Okay, this is the participatory and the level of influence. You know, this means that if the left hand is the level of participation, and on the right hand is techniques, you know. So on the technique is on the, let's say on the basic, we say, okay, we have they know about thing, they have information, that is the very basic. And then they have been told before decision, and we call upgrade to kind of advisory group. And then we can have influence on decision, you know, or at that level, it kind of a collaboration, you know, or negotiation. And on the highest, you know, we can have kind of agreement in decision. So I mean, participation is very high, you know, and we can have kind of joint decision making. Actually in Thailand, you know, like in especially that I will discuss with you in detail tomorrow, we have joint management committee for the river basin, not for the project, you know, it's for the whole river basin. We have joint management committee that developed from the water user group for an integrated project group. And that is only inside the irrigation project. But right now we have the committee to cover the whole basin, the whole river, not only the, not the basin, the river itself, because the basin, they have river basin committee. But the joint management committee is talking about river only, not the basin. The river from the upstream, that is the storage dam, to the people that use water along the side, to the diversion dam, and then from the diversion dam to irrigation, and downstream of the diversion dam to the, you know, people use of the city, people use of the environment, fisheries, those kind of things. You know, so our ultimate goal is that, okay, the participants have to go up to the top. You know, it means they have been involved in the decision making, and they have the involved in the committee. Like I talk in Thailand, we call it joint management committee. Okay, we have a break for 10 minutes or so, you know, so we can have refreshment and we come back later in maybe, let's say 10 or 15 minutes. Okay, we have a break now. Okay, see you in 10 minutes. Okay. Okay, hopefully you are well, you know. Oh, I don't know how is the COVID situation in your area, but, you know, just a bad news for me, you know, just my assistant, you know, just have COVID today. Oh, okay. Okay, we just complete about the, you know, the participation level, you know, from the beginning up to the most comprehensive, you know, to the decision making, to the joint management committee. Okay, so this is just the mode of participation. You know, we have kind of maybe one way communication, that is a basic one, you know, we call, okay, just inform people what is there, what has been done, and we have kind of another thing, it's consultation, so it means kind of two-way communication. Yeah, there is another step, and we can have kind of collaboration work. This in work a long time, and lastly, the, you know, accept, you know, so the third is good, people already involved, but the last one, empowering, that is important, that people accept responsibility. This picture just taking, I think, from the same vegetable irrigation project that farmer have been guaranteed in terms of water, and they have the responsibility in other things like operation maintenance I discussed earlier. So we have to develop process to match the project water management solution with, you know, government to the stakeholder consultation, you know. And we have to organize the community to be involved in the water management, you know, like I said earlier, not only maintenance, but they have to be involved in monitoring and also maybe allocation, this kind of thing, or management. Yeah. So they adopt a participatory and negotiation approach that is for water allocation. What does it mean? It means that, okay, maybe we have the water allocation plan, like when we are going to start the water delivery for each season, and maybe the farmer can have a kind of meeting or consultation that, okay, we want to move the forward or we the backward, you know, And in the irrigation project that I have worked with, you know, the farmer can even change their own quota. Like, okay, early, you know, they need water less, they can keep water for the future. Or in the future, they can take the water that have been kept for them in the early state that they don't want to use that time. Those kind of thing, you know, but this is the kind of allocation or water delivery that can be more flexible by the participation process. Yeah. But this means that we have storage, you know, to store the water. That's why we can keep that and keep it for farmers at a later time. And we need to develop collaborative framework, you know, for the Liberian stakeholder. Yeah, that is quite important, you know. You know, for in the river itself, the Liberian stakeholder is quite important that, okay, they are no, you know, not invade into the river and how to protect the river, you know. And do they know that anything you do at the upstream can affect the people at the downstream, so on. So we have to promote the participation for all level, you know, and for all partnership, as kind of partnership. Okay. Like I discussed in the beginning, that how can we help the poor, you know, to participate, you know, rather than the people who have more influence. Okay. So this talking about the monitoring and dispute resolution, you know, like I discussed earlier, you know, the dispute resolution cannot be sustainable achieved by the officer. It has to be designed by the group of farmer through water user group, you know. Maybe they have kind of unofficial regulation, but later they will have kind of written or official regulation to work together. Okay, like I talked about, we have a penalty in terms of water allocation, penalty in terms of money, or some other means. Okay. But of course, we need assistance in terms of tools, guidelines, you know, for the participatory process, you know, like, okay, they need to have some kind of manuals, you know, that we help them in terms of operation, in terms of water allocation, in terms of understand the system, understand the river, understand the environment, you know, many supplements that really have to be provide. If irrigation project, it has to be provided by the Arroyo Irrigation Department. If in the basin, it has to be provided by River Basin Secretary, you know, that is under the National Water Resource Office, you know, Office of National Water Resources, that have the that being the Secretary of the River Basin, okay? Or ID in terms of irrigation project, okay? So the dams and storage, but is the, you know, big project, it have to be, to have the people participate, you know, in terms of agreement, you know, on the construction, agreement on the design, agreement on the beneficiary group, and the agreement on the people who have the effect, you know, or have the kind of impact on them, you know. How can we be sure that everybody have been participate, you know, and everybody have been involved, and we get kind of let's say consensus or agreement, you know, that have been acceptable by all parties. You know, it doesn't mean that everybody get what they want, but it means that everybody have kind of good feeling about the project, you know, that it doesn't affect them much. You know, of course, people who have benefit will be happy, but people who have effect have to be at least acceptable for the consequence, but they will have it, okay? And this talk about the women role or strengthening of women ability to participate, but in turn, we have not no problem at all. Because right now, so many leader of the local administration is female. We have actually governor, many governor also female. We can have, you know, even minister that is female. We already have the female prime minister even, okay? So we have no problem about that. And I think many, many, many countries, we don't have any problem with that, okay? And say we have explicit participant to the poor. This is the point has been raised again, you know, that any related project, how can we participate them? How can we let them involve? Because they have maybe less influence than the other group. And of course, the strengthened institutional arrangement, you know, but it means the government or the agency have to be accommodated particularly to the community or to the local administration level, okay? Lastly, okay, this is the last point that I'm going to discuss today is about the case study of the participatory irrigation management in Thailand. So let's first point here, I say that we need to have a chain for water project management, you know, because in the past we don't have this PIM, you know, we have the kind of water user group, but the participatory process is really weak, you know. So we have the new constitution in 2007. This is the first constitution of the country that endorsed the participation of people in most activity of the government. You know, that's why after we accept the IWRM, this constitution also endorsed the participation in our process too, you know. And it also the policy of the government, you know, as constitution already endorsed that. And also the ID also have raised a PIM. Actually, they have initiated a new organization called the, Office of People Participation. Of supporting people for participation, something like that in the ID, you know. And also the PIM itself, it get more attention on international level. That is about, let's say, 2007, that is about 15 years ago, you know, that I start working really heavily on the PIM, okay. And we get support from the IMI, from FAO too. The first project I work officially for Thailand is on the FAO sponsor. You know, and they say that, okay, we have the constitutional support, we have the government regulation support, you know, we have a strategy of the government, and we have some other law to support that. That's why our participatory is quite going, maybe it takes time, but it's quite smooth. Maybe some disrupt, but not that much. Okay. And we also propose that the irrigation project have to go through what called service-oriented irrigation management. What does this mean? It means that the project have to listen to the water user more, you know, and have to, let's say, okay, the irrigation season, maybe start a little bit early, a little bit late, according to water use, can we do that? And also the water allocation can be a little more flexible, the type of thing, you know? And we propose here two level, you know, and okay, the on the field level, we have, you know, water use, we have, let's say, a lateral system, that means it may be controlled by the, the level of irrigation, it means this lateral controlled by the farmer, and lateral main controlled by the government, you know, and the other one is what activity have to be involved. You know, we have a water use activity, we have control activity, we have organization activity. So the contribution can be on all of these issues or this activity. Like water use, it can be involved in, you know, measuring water, opening the gate by themselves, arrange among themselves. They can have control structure, they can, you know, be responsible to gate opening or gate closing. And organization of they have been involved in distributing the information, making water allocation, those kind of things by themselves. And now today in Thailand, they even have a kind of collecting money to support themselves in doing their job, like monitoring those kind of things, because we need some petrol, you know, for people to go along and close or open or measuring something by farmer themselves. So the other member contribute some money to help. You know, they're the one who volunteer to do the job. Okay. This is the kind of, you know, metric to show the organization control structure and water use activity, similar to the other one. Okay, we skip this. This is just show you know, the simple system to the complicated system. The right hand side, that is the large scale system. And let's say, like February that I mentioned, we have main canal, we have secondary canal, we have tertiary canal, and then we have field ditch. And the last one, that is the small scale, the right hand, the left hand side. I will discuss with you tomorrow also one of the example of the small scale that we have worked with them in the last 10, 15 years. So, you know, small reservoir. Small scale that they only have main canal and then field ditch, that's all. Okay. And this is just the strategy for the success of the PIM. You know, here we actually recommend service agreement, that maybe it's not common in many country or in many part, but in Thailand it's still used in some, only in some project, you know, not every project have this. You know, some project have this. We call it service agreement. It's agreement between farmer and officer. What kind of water, what kind of seed we will deliver to the farmer, and what is the farmer mode of participation? You know, what is the expectation from each of them? You know, this is another level. You know, actually, we have a process of signing ceremony. We have been involved in maybe 10 years ago in the project. Yeah, there. Okay. And of course, water delivery have to be the part of the PIM, you know, in order to support that. Okay, you know, the participant can have kind of flexible, you know, water delivery. And of course, water use group must have the must be strengthened. And have the legal status. Right now we have the water laws, and in this law, you know, it's recognized the water user group, and even there are the RID laws, you know, that call irrigation laws, also recognize the water user group, but only inside the irrigation. Now today water law recognize the water user group outside or even inside irrigation project. Okay. And the other part here, I'm talking about operation, maintenance, and management have to be together in the PIM, you know. And lastly, here we talk about water fee, like maybe in cash to help the activity of the group,
you know, in terms of maintenance, in terms of operation, in terms of the cost by the, you know, volunteer or people who be the one who do the job on the, let's say, regulation, opening the gate, or those type of thing. Or even, you know, sometimes that if you are not participate in maintenance, you know, sometimes you were charged by the farmer user group. You know, like some particular member do not show up on the day of the cleaning of the canal or cleaning of the system. They have to pay the money to the group. There is some example. This is just a framework, you know, the participation. You know, we have the service agreement as the supporting, and we have water delivery, water fees, kind of mechanism as a tool. And this is working on the water use group under the PIM that have been supported by the capacity building, you know. And this is overall of concept of service oriented irrigation management. So it means the project have to be more flexible and people have to be more involvement, you know. So the irrigation agency maybe can be considered as a service provider. I don't mean that we do it in overall the country, but we have done it in some of irrigation projects. Yeah, but not all. A few of them we achieve in this, but the majority we still have to work on it. You know, to in order to have a more of a good system that going along. People participation that we can call it service oriented irrigation management. It is strategy for the success of PIM, you know, so it have, we need to recruit the party with the water user group, irrigation project or officer and or local administration or, you know, some kind of community, and we can have other organization that working along, you know. But of course, in order for everybody to work together, it need to have incentive. And everybody have to be on a win-win situation. You know, it means that if you participate, you need to get something, or you need to really satisfy with the process, not just really contribute, but nothing back. You feel really upset, you know, okay, I do this, I do that, but I don't get anything back from the system or from the project, okay? At least maybe some influence, at least some benefit or whatever, you know. Okay, people asking about the dredging of the reservoir. Okay, and maybe I interrupt this a little bit, maybe because of some of the organizer told me that they have some question about sedimentation removal. In Thailand, I would say that the sedimentation removal is not really practiced very much, especially in the last reservoir, because it really costly, you know. But it is under consideration only for the region where the water is scarce, and the investment for dredging is feasible. You know, for example, right now we are in the process of maybe dredging a big reservoir in the eastern part of the country that is called economic EEC. Maybe you if you have a look at EEC, Eastern Economic Corridor, that is a driving force for the country by the industry, by the service. And we have so many reservoirs, and many of them have a problem of some sedimentation. And we have a plan to remove, you know, the sediment in order to get them back in shape. But this have been done only in the region where water is very important and it is a driving force for the country. But in the other region, so far, we haven't done that sediment removal very much. And sediment in Thailand maybe not the big problem compared to Africa or compared to the other region. We have, but the rate is still not that big. You know, I would say that, for example, the first large reservoir in Thailand, that is the Bumiphon Dam in the Pink River, that is very big. That is what, how much? The capacity is about, I think it's 14 billion cubic meter. That's big, you know. It's 14 billion cubic meter, but it's still, the sedimentation, I think it's only maybe 10% or less, something like that. Not that much, you know. So we say in Thailand, for the large reservoir, we have that not much problem. But for some small reservoir, we have maybe quicker sediment. Okay, but so far, the issue of removal is not really big in Thailand, because of we think that it still can work, and we think that it's not cost effectively to do that, except in some region where water is very important for the economy. Okay, that is my answer for that. Come back to the water user group. Here, we have the copying pattern should be implemented according to water. Okay, right now we are in Thailand, you know, working toward of, you know, water productivity. What does it mean? It means we try to use water more wisely, get more production per unit of water. Okay, and try to use water saving technique, like in Thailand right now, if we go rice, we are going along with the calling wet and dry technique, who will really use water less, maybe 20 or 30% less. This is my research have been done on it more than 10 years ago. And now I have accepted that the wet and dry technique will be one of the basic practice for the farmer. And the farmer group that I will discuss about tomorrow, they also have done that. They also developed the technique to measure water on the farm by themselves, you know, in order to monitor that, okay, well, should they irrigate now? Or can they wait for some more day? So the water seepage will be reduced, water evaporation can be reduced if they irrigate later, not now. You know, because the rice, even the rice have solar for some, you know, water level that is really low underneath the surface, you know. That doesn't have to be the ponding all the time, okay? And water will be, second point here is delivery have to be flexible, okay? Like I talked to you earlier, it have to be flexible toward the farmer. And in some case, you know, in the many projects in Thailand, the farmer have to help themselves when the water is insufficient. They have to use their own money to pump the water, you know, from the drainage system or from the other source. You know, but if you have good water allocation, like we have done in February, before we implement the PIM successfully, people have to pump at the end of the at the tail end of the system. But right now they don't have to do that. At least on the elderly situation, but on some rare case they have to do that. Okay, water allocation management will be implemented by the water user group. Okay, it's a first one. Oh, sorry, there are some kind of hanging. Okay, moving now. Okay, somebody. Okay, water management under limited number of staff. Okay, that will be important. Why we need to get the support from the water user group. Like I discussed earlier, that when we have less number of staff, we can project have to get farmer to work with them. And water delivery plan, you know, and information have to be promote the efficiency, effectiveness, and water productivity. Yeah. And particularly have to be on both operation and maintenance, you know. And final, I mentioned about the budget, that sometimes the project doesn't get enough money for, you know, operation and even for maintenance. And I mean, somehow we get to get them such a sufficient. Otherwise, we go to the process like we call rehabilitation. After the project deteriorate a lot, okay, we don't want to hear that. Okay, that the project deteriorate up to the point that we need to. Sorry, hang here. Okay, moving now. And the of course the local administration in our process, you know, we let the district or even the local administration know about the agreement between the people or the water user and the agency. So they will be the part. Maybe they can help in terms of maintenance. Maybe they can help in some of the supporting because the people, it belong to them anyway. Or they can work along, you know, in terms of planning or in terms of setting. That is so successful. Well, right now, today, in the past, you know, we can have some local officer, we can have some district officer coming to the project and complain or doing something. But right now, after they participate, they do not complain because they already know everything, what we are doing. We know, they know the agreement between the project and the farmer. And they even know the water scheduling, you know, okay. It's been open. People can have a look at that. Okay, this is just as a party, you know, that may be interested in the project. You know, like maybe academics, maybe NGO, maybe whatever, you know. So okay, they can be participate, you know, as outside to have a look at it, you know. So the prime benefit, you know, for the water allocation and management. After that, we have to be more accurate, more flexible, more reliable, and more efficiency. So this is all the merit, you know. And the planning is more effective, and maybe you loss it really minimize. You know, after we have been more flexible for the farmer and people who have been informed everything beforehand. Okay. This is the support for the success team. You know, okay. I talked earlier. This lack here that we have go along to the service oriented. Irrigation management that in Thailand, most of the projects still not go to this concept. Yet it's still very much on the early management, you know, and service agreement of two that may be quite important if you want to make it really successful. And now our water user group, it have been legalized, and of course the money involved in the project of monitoring and maintenance. This is about our national level PIM, you know, that we have not so much successful in overall, you know, because it's no incentive for water user because we have no guarantee for the farmer in terms of water, you know. And also the government agency, you know, that they have delivery, operation, maintenance. If they work separately, it's going to be difficult, you know. And of course, the PIM, when we try to implement it, it have to be guaranteed by reliable water, you know, and we can start by operation, and then we can get people more involved in maintenance, more involved in management. Yeah. And of course, finally, you know, we want to have a basic water user group, develop to integrate water user group. That is a many, many small group together. And if we have a JMC joint management committee, it means the whole river is having under the decision making, you know, by their representative.
Doctor, I have a question.
Yes, please.
The water allocations in Thailand, how to allocate the water fairly among the user when they face the water scarcity?
Okay.
And in terms of what situation and I mean, based on what principle does you allocate the water to each user? They request the water or what?
Okay. First of all, for the water allocation, mostly we have, for last irrigation project, we have irrigation schedule. So they have to grow along with the irrigation schedule. Like you will receive water every 10 days or every 2 weeks. You know, that's kind of thing of that. Okay.
and they have to go along with that. But the amount of water for each rotation may be different, depending on the request or depending on the variable water. And in terms of scarcity, we have two ways to deal with that. Sometimes we extend the rotation, you know. At first, we have a look at what is the situation of the crop now? What stage are the crop in? It is on the stage that water shortage will be not much effect. We will reduce water. But if the crop is on the stage that the water is so important, like the mature, like the you know, flowering, those kind of things, we try to be sure that the farmer get the water. And we use kind of sharing, you know, okay, we can extend the period maybe from 10 days to two weeks. And we can have, let's say, okay, you don't get the water at 100% at this time, you will get 90%, 80%. But they will be notified beforehand, you know. And anybody who grow the crops out of this planning, let's say that maybe we have allowed people for 10,000 hectare, let's say, or maybe a 5,000 hectare to grow. But if maybe people grow 6,000 or 7,000 and water is insufficient, some of them have to be out, you know, because they are outside the program, those kind of things, but all they get less care of water. Okay, that what we have done. And sometimes we support them by pumping, you know, let's say we have at the tail end of the system, we can support them with some kind of pump to get the pump from the drain system back to the field, those kind of things. And some farmer maybe use the groundwater. Because in Thailand, we have still, well, let's say in the central plain, we have good groundwater. So many farmers help themselves by using the groundwater, the shallow well groundwater. You know, in some other part, maybe groundwater not actually abundant, but in central plain, many farmers will go for groundwater if actually they have water shortage or water deficit or water scarcity. So, but in the Northeast, maybe a little bit different that groundwater, sometimes they have problem of the saline water and something, but maybe that in that case, the planning and the water management have to be more careful because the supplementary water is very difficult to get. But of course, we have a look at the state of the crop and we try to be sure that the critical stage of the crop, the water has to get at least sufficient or close to the point that is no effect on the yield. But in the duration, in the time that it has less effect to the crop, of course, we reduce the water when we have water scarcity. Okay, I hope that it answers your question.
Yes, thank you.
Okay.
And maybe another one is related to water user community. In case of Thailand, the operator of the scheme?
You mean the small scale irrigation?
Yes, small scale.
Small scale, we have the irrigation officer as a consultant. Just tell them on kind of water calculation, those kind of things. But the operation mostly by the committee by themselves. They will form the water user group, and they will elect some of them to be the, let's say, the management group of the project, and they will allocate somebody who have responsible for opening, closing the gate, and some other thing, and they will do by themselves under the let's say consultation or assistant of the officer, and even the collecting the money they will do by themselves, and even the regulation they do by themselves. Mostly that for most of the small scale illegal check in Thailand. Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
This is just about some faculty for the second of him. You know, we have to meet the project management and water master, you know, to have at least understand important for the BIM, you know, and have to build the trust, you know, for the farmer that, okay, we will do that. We will have a kind of robust system and flexible system for them, you know, and that is the top level. And of course, we have the training for the field staff, for the water user, you know, to understand everything.
And of course, we need to have the manual. Actually, in Thailand, IID have provided manuals, but it's still a little bit, maybe need some improvement, you know. Okay. It's just a step that the IID have developed the manual. You know, it's consist of what? Building the understanding, solution, service, you know, at, go along up to the development of the basic information project. Okay. Maybe I can help you this user prim, you know, maybe this diagram show you the IID prim process. You know, they go along with the building understanding, service agreement, you know, what basic water user group, and after some time the basic water user group developed to integrate water user group. I mean many water user group combined together to become integrated water user group. They have the capacity building, they have evaluation, they have participation, evaluation and maintenance, you know, and at the end, you know, we hope that they can upgrade to joint management committee, you know, and okay. And for the assistant of the farmer group, sometimes we have something called contract maintenance to water user group. This is just to help them, you know, to in case of we need some concrete, we need some civil work, we will help them in thermal material, and the farmer do the maintenance by themselves. Okay. And of course, we have some kind of funding here. This is a framework of IID. Okay. I work with them and propose something a little bit more different. Maybe I show you the picture. Okay, I just, because initially they will initiate the water user group. And after some time, they will upgrade that water user group to integrate water user group. But under the international standard or my observing, it's not like that. We have to initiate water user group and integrate water user group at the same time inside the project. Why? Because water user group, maybe we have 100 of them or even more in the project. And it's hard to get all representatives working together with the government. So but if they combine many water user group to be integrated, that the bigger group. So let's say in the project, maybe you have only 5 or 10 integrated water user group, and the representative can work with the project. It can be repetitive. After we get some agreement, after we get some allocation, get something, they can distribute them back to the water group. And even integrate water user group can organize the allocation inside their own group. You know, right now, many projects, the integrate themselves can communicate into water user group and allocate more the water along their own group. I think that is what we are moving now. So starting water user group along with the integrated water user group at the same time, you know. But of course, the GMC is the theme that, okay, can go up outside irrigation project, you know. So it means irrigation project plus somebody outside that maybe get some kind of benefit or involvement in the river or in the water that can be working together. You know, apart from the only the inside the project, okay, that the joint management committee. Of course, we need to have participatory in the operation and maintenance and monitoring, you know, and we have the evaluation. And we need some service agreement if possible, you know, if we have some service agreement, it will be very strong for the farmer, because the commitment for the farmer and the commitment from the officer, you have to be both, you know. In order to okay, if I do this, you do that, you know. So both of us have to do something, not just only the farmer or not just only the officer. Okay, that is that evaluation. And of course, we have some support, we have some training, some seminar, some funding to have something, or we have some civil work some material for to help the farmer user group to do the work. Okay, this is just an indicator to evaluate, you know, some of the water user group, you know, for the water allocation, for the water group activity, for the satisfactory of the stakeholder, and for the efficiency of the project. This is for indicators for the evaluation indicator. Is it some more detail about the water allocation? You know, we maybe I won't go into detail, like, you know, this is very much technical, you know, like the DBR, delivery performance ratio is mean like, okay, how much water has been developed? How much water has been planned? What is the difference? Why? Okay. Equity. And then secondly, for the water user group and activity, you know, it's a ratio between water group and O&M activity by them, or some group who haven't participated, how much compared to between these two. And there, and some of the thing, you know, is about what do they know and do they participate? Okay. Of course, we have the satisfactory of the stakeholder, you know, to the project, to the water user themselves, you know. And of course, we have a look at the efficiency, we have a look at the water productivity, we have a look at some other thing, how much money they earn for water, okay. This is just overall comment on the PIM. It has to be benefit both farmer and officer. And the water allocation have to be part of the program. And of course, if possible, we encourage to have water fee. But water fee is not for the project. Water fee is for the water user group. So use for their own expense in terms of traveling, in terms of monitoring, those kind of things, in terms of meeting, or even in terms of, you know, some other thing, because we need some money, you know, when we do a lot of activity. And if possible, contract, you know, between the water user group and agency, you know. Okay. And of course, equity and conflict resolution is quite important. And farmer should participate not only on operation, it has to be on maintenance. And participate start from this, the lowest level, up to maybe tertiary, and maybe up to secondary. You know, but the main canal may be too difficult for them, you know, to participate. And it has to be voluntary. It means that they have to be learning process. They have to understand and they have to know the benefit of being participate, okay, and you have to go step by step. But if you have installed a group, water user group, by no understanding or no willingness, you have the group, but no activity, just the static, no dynamic moving, no benefit, you know, just on the paper. That's quite the old story of Thailand. Maybe 30 years ago, we have water use all around the country, every project. But it doesn't work because it's on the paper, but no activity, you know. And requirement of maintenance may be reduced, you know, by the up. And this is just to help that, okay, good project. How we do that? We need a good design. We need a proper operation. We need the preventive maintenance or sufficient maintenance. And we need to have some other measure like soil conservation and those kind of control. So operation and maintenance, of course, have to be participated by water user. But of course, they need to get some benefit from that. Okay, better water allocation, better water management, participating in decision making, those kind of things. And some kind of guarantee that they will get water for sure. And if they don't get it, they have to be informed beforehand why and how much they will get. Okay. Is it just supplement about talking about irrigation management transfer that have been endorsed by the FAO, that is quite important, you know, this is done by IMI, you know, or rather we'll get that it's just report that, okay, irrigation management transfer have been done on different level, you know, from the only have water user group up to the farmer only participate and doing the operation by themselves. This is just a table to tell you, you know, on that. Sorry. Okay, this is just the the survey or the work have been done correct on many parts of the world. Yeah, some in Asia, some in Latin America, this kind. You know, you can see the level. You know, most of them are only have the, you know, have the policy or work about, you know, water issue. That is quite, you know, minimum. Because the top of this table is just a small participation. But if you go down to the bottom, that is mean that water user group have been involved more. You can see that most of the number on the top is mean that people participate not so much in terms of water user group, you know. Okay. This is just to tell you that irrigation management transfer is quite important. You know, from this study, they say that it can, of course, reduce of the O&M cost by the government. You can see the right hand side on the top can be decreased. You know, out of, you know, all nearly 30 projects out of what 40 cases, the cost reduced. But of course, there are some few projects that have cost have been increased. And of course, they have farmer. Maybe surprisingly, you think that okay, in the irrigation management transfer, the cost of farmer to be increased. But you can see here in this figure 9, some of them decrease, or only some of them increase. Cause it is the talking about money and talking about the water equity. So it's clear that equity is good. The time to receive water has been better. The equity have been better, you know, in terms of irrigation managed transfer. That's why I discussed earlier irrigation for the small scale irrigation project. It have to be by the farmer, not by the agency. But of course, this scale is too difficult. And this is talking about crop yield, you know, area irrigated and farm income. It's all mostly increased. So that's why, I mean, to support the water user group, irrigation management transfer, especially for small scale irrigation project, quite important. Okay. This is just some additional comment from me on the small scale water resource project. Since I have worked with both large scale and small scale, so I give some recommend on the small scale here. You know, my point is, you know, the small scale, the crop cultivation have to support the local need, and the wet season have to be the prime target, you know, because the dry season, maybe the water availability is not so much. And it have to be the water delivery, water application have to fit with the local technology, condition technology. And of course, capacity building in terms of irrigation and agricultural knowledge, it have to be transfer to the farmer. And of course, farmer user group have to be strengthened, at least understand about water allocation, water need by the crop, you know, and some other things. So the assistant have to be from the officer to at least to be the consultant, to be the advisor to them. So the for the water user, it have to be clearly defined what is the responsibility before irrigation. You know, what should they do? Survey the land, know about water supply, have the meeting, and during irrigation, they have to check the water is delivered according to the plan. It have been, you know, measuring, it have been adjusted, you know, and at the end, they have to be participate, you know, in the maintenance, have a kind of meeting for improving of water quality, you know. Okay, it is for pumping station, you know, farmer have to pay for the cost of electricity, of course, have to be able to have the collection system for them to pay for this, and they have to understand about the energy consumption and energy saving. You know, and have operation plan is quite important because pumping water, it means paying money. You know, so operation plan has to be good and reduce the loss. You know, and every farmer have to be the member of course, because otherwise it's difficult for them to collect the money and pay. And of course there are some maintenance, you know, maybe farmer have to pay for maintenance. If not possible, can the local administration helping them, because the agency may be difficult, but the farmer have to work with the local administration or community to get some support if they are not able to maintain by themselves. Is it about the PIM in the support of the small scale? You know, people have to understand the principle. People have to know that, okay, it has been important for water requirement understanding and water supply understanding. And of course, I talk about your fee for the group for the operation and maintenance by themselves. You know, an agreement among themselves and the rule, regulation. We will talk a lot of this kind, a lot of detail tomorrow about water user group and regulation and water chart and then penalty and discuss things. Okay. Think that enough for today. We spend more than 2.5 hours. And tomorrow we have a look in some video of our field visit, and you know, and on the water user group itself and on experience of PIM. You know, hopefully you can learn something from that. But sorry that you cannot be here. Otherwise, we have opportunity to be together in the field, discuss with farmer, discuss with water user group. But anyway, I have some video to show you from one big irrigation project and one small irrigation project that operate totally by the farmer. Anybody have some more question? Okay, if not, okay, we will close our session now, and we have post, you know, posted after this.
Sorry, Prof, I have dropped a question on the
chat. Okay, okay, sure. Please. Okay.
Oh, sorry. I was saying I dropped a question on the chat, but anyway, let me utilize the opportunity. I was just wondering, how do you manage the reservoir sedimentation problem in Thailand? You know, in southern Africa, the reservoirs that we have, they were built some 30 to 40 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And in your presentation, you indicated that the reservoirs have to be rehabilitated or maintained around 30 to 40 years. So what we have realized is that indeed the population is increasing, but water availability is reducing, because this reservoir, they were designed to store a certain volume of water, but through siltation, the volume is significantly reduced, and therefore, I don't know, dredging is too costly to remove this sediment. Mm-hmm. So I wanted to perhaps know, how do you manage siltation problem in Thailand? Thank you.
Yeah. I think this is quite difficult, you know, in terms of siltation removal, because it's really costly. You know, because in Thailand, like I tell you, in the area where the water is not really valuable, you know, so far we didn't do that, because it's too costly. We do that only in the region where water is very scarce, and also it's very important for the development of the region. But for my point is, if we implement the water saving technology, you know, it will help a lot, you know, because like say now today we have a lot of technique, like if we go rice, we have kind of wet and dry technique that can reduce water by at least 20%. If we go upland crop, we can have kind of technique called water deficit that we do a lot. I think it has been impacted a lot in India, in South Asia, in some other region, even in China. You know, it's mean that the technique that we only irrigate when it's in need. The maybe irrigate at the minimum. Then the yield still not very much reduced. It's still about the same, but the amount of water can be reduced by some 10, 20, or even more. You know, the classic. For example, I have worked with sugar cane. You know, for irrigation, we don't use the surface. We use the drip irrigation for sugar cane, and it can be reduced water by more than half. And also, we use kind of supplement irrigation, supplementary irrigation, like sugar cane for the whole season for 1 year. We irrigate only for 4 times. You know, but we know the critical period to ignite the yield, to reduce the loss. Like, okay, the time of, you know, the yield formation, you know, on the time that sugarcane start to have a more of the stem, those kind of thing. And I will even work with the cassava, you know, like in Thailand now today, you know, if we don't have irrigation at all, sugarcane, we have some kind of, it's very difficult to convert unit, maybe, but let's say it increased by double. With limited irrigation, only 4 times a year for sugarcane, and we use drip irrigation. Sometimes we even import the water from outside by the tank, but it's still get the benefit back from the water we transfer in, you know. And the other thing is for cassava, then our experiment showed that if we irrigate cassava, and the yield can be double, you know, and the we don't have to do that for the whole year, but it has to be a certain period of time that it a certain amount, you know, that it can help. So what I mean is to removal of the silt from the reservoir is just too expensive to do that, because the cost of petrol, the cost of labor, the cost of, but in Thailand we tend to construct or enlarge or do other thing rather than try to do the siltation, except the case that the reservoir there itself is on location that it's not possible to construct a new one, or even it's important for us to maintain the water or to get a certain amount of water, other than we try to go for water saving technology or water reduction technology, or try to get the same yield or the same benefit by using less water. You know, that what we are practicing right now. Okay, I hope that helped you.
Okay, indeed, it helped me. I saw one of your slides where you were referring to participatory approach, and mm-hmm. then you showed a picture of the end users cleaning mm-hmm. a canal.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I was just wondering if perhaps in future, do we have to, I don't know how to clean a reservoir, maybe adopt a similar approach every second year or every 5 years to perhaps remove the siltation, because I don't know, it looks like it will definitely forever increase, because reservoir, they just store water that is coming from the river, so they uh-huh. sand deposit. Uh-huh. So with time, this sand builds up, and then, yeah, water availability becomes an issue. I understand the approach that you explained, that we must come up with water saving approaches and all that, but mm-hmm. this reservoir levels or water availability diminishes with time. Mm-hmm. So at the moment, it is a situation of maybe the past 4 decades. So I'm just wondering, in the next 4 to 6 decades, let's say 100 years, how the reservoir level will be diminished significantly, therefore. So I don't, yeah, and dredging is expensive. So I'm just thinking if, sorry for that. If cleaning, I don't know, we adopt a participatory approach where these reservoirs can be cleaned every 5 years or 2 years, will that perhaps help?
Yeah, I think that's a good point. So we can see that, you know, can we do that? But for Thailand, you know, since we didn't have that much problem of sediment, you know, we have some, but maybe much less than you have some the sediment in Africa, you know, because of, I think, something, one thing, I will recommend that we implement
severe water reservoir conservation upstream of the reservoir. We promote the reforestation, the let's say we call it a check dam on the upstream of the reservoir. To the check dam will trap the sediment, so the sediment doesn't go into the reservoir. It has been trapped before it come into the reservoir, so it doesn't reduce, and we call it check dam. It has been implemented throughout Thailand, especially the northern part, and we have done it in the last more than 10 years and have been participate on that a lot. I have been also teaching lecture on the, sorry, I forgot to mention about it. We call it check dam for the upstream to trap the sediment, not to go into the reservoir, and also to increase the water seepage into the ground, to increase the water to underground water, and also, you know, can give a good health for the forest, because the water is stay there for longer. And I think this kind of technique may be more applicable and easier, you know, and we've done that a lot on the watershed conservation by using check dam, reforestation, or some other technique. Okay, I think that will be helping.
No, thank you very much. I think that's a brilliant idea, the check dam. Thanks.
Okay, I think I have to go there because I have some other arrangement. If you, anybody have more some question? Otherwise, okay, we have come to the end now. Oh, thank you very much for your participation. Tomorrow, we see each other again. Hopefully, we have opportunity to discuss in more practical thing, and we show you some video of user group. And if you have some question, then it's not enough time to ask today. Tomorrow, we have more time, because tomorrow will be more discussion rather than lecture. Okay, see you tomorrow then. Bye for now. See you tomorrow.
Okay, thanks you.
Post it for everyone. Can I send the post it to the chat? I just sent the post-it for the IWRM and PIM from Dr. Wen Cha. Could you please do the post-it and send it to the Google Classroom? Thank you very much.